What's good, everybody? I'm glad that you are all here with us today for Vespers. As you can see, we are online due to COVID, which also means that the student churches will also be online tomorrow, but they will be live streaming on YouTube. So go ahead and check those out tomorrow. If you didn't know, today is the last weekend before break, which on one hand, it's relieving, exciting. On the other hand, it's scary and stressful because of finals, which is not fun. But I urge you not to be in the future, but to be present here, worshiping the Lord.
My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is your health and salvation. Come, all who hear, now to His temple draw near. The Lord above all things so wondrously reigning, sheltering you under His wings and so gently sustaining. Have you not seen all that is needful has been fed by His gracious ordain? Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with His love He befriends you. Praise to the Lord.
Hope you guys are doing good. My name is Warren Begay. I am a sophomore theology major, and I would like to pray. Please bow your heads. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for being with us. I pray that you be with all of our families, you be with our studies. Finals are getting pretty close. I just pray that you be with us as we study for that, and that when finals are over, that a lot of us have safe travels back home. But for right now, Lord, please give us wisdom and strength to get through this week and next week. I thank you for all the things you've done for us, and pray that you continue to be with all of us. I pray this in your name. Amen.
Hello and good evening, everyone. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker for this week. His name is Adrian Marston. For any returning students who may know him, and for any new students, he was the Associate Chaplain for Ministries here at Walla Walla University last year. We miss him so much, but he is currently living his best life up in Maryland, and is recently married to his wife. So I invite you to welcome Adrian tonight as he gives our word, and I'm so excited to hear what he has to say.
Good evening, everyone. Happy Sabbath to all of you that are tuning in. My name is Adrian Marston. For those of you that have not met me yet, It is a blessing to be in front of you guys and to see you all for the first time. And for those of you that do know me, I miss you all. I have prayed for each and every one of you every day, every night. And it is unfortunate that this opportunity could not be done in better circumstances, but I do want to make sure that I take the time to say that I miss you all and that you are loved and you are thought of. And we will see each other soon. We will see each other soon. Before I begin with my sermon, I just want to take an opportunity to invite the Holy Spirit here with us. So let's bow our heads. Father God, I just want to take an opportunity to invite you here in this moment, in this space. God, right now I'm asking that the words that these people hear are not of my own, God, but of your voice and your words alone. We love you and we thank you. Amen. The year was 1955. A young Black woman is seen sitting on the bus that's completely full, patiently waiting for her stop. Tiredly, she looks down at her watch, eager to get home. Suddenly, she notices that the bus is coming down to a halt. She lifts up her head to figure out what's happening, and she sees the driver stop and open the door to a large crowd of white Americans wanting to get on board. What happens next is a story that she is all too familiar with. The driver gets up from his seat. He turns around and observes the passengers that are all seated on this bus, assessing who he'll choose to give this unpleasant news. The Black woman who is sitting in the back knows what's about to happen. Due to her darker skin complexion, it is inevitable that she'll be asked to give up her seat for her white counterpart. Now, we don't know the exact thought process that this woman had, nor can we describe the specific emotions that fueled her to choose this day in an act of defiance. Because on this day, she refuses to give up her seat. The bus driver orders her to get up, and she refuses over and over again until finally two police officers pull up to the scene with handcuffs in their hands and they arrest this young woman. By now, one can assume that this is the story of the famous Rosa Parks and her courageous act of defiance by choosing to not give up her seat. However, that is not who this story is about. Because before Rosa Parks, there was another brave young Black woman who chose to sit in defiance against racism. Her name was Claudette Colvin, and her story is retold in a book titled Claudette Colvin, Twice Towards Justice. The author of the book, Phil Hoos, says that, and I quote, despite a few articles about her in the Birmingham Press and in USA Today, and a brief mentions in some books about the civil rights movement, most people don't know who Claudette Colvin is and the role that she played in the bus boycotts. Hoos couldn't get over the fact that this young girl, just 9 months before Rosa Parks, where they lived in the same city, they used the same bus system with very same tough consequences, hauled off the bus in handcuffs and jailed. And for some reason, no one knew about this young woman. This story with the same setting, the same circumstances, and the same protest as Rosa Parks was somehow forgotten in history. And so one has to ask why. Why wasn't this story chosen to be seen as a catalyst or the symbol that embodies this bus boycott? Well, in an article written by the NPR, we learned that the NAACP and other Black organizations felt that Parks' story would be a better serving icon to the movement, although Colvin shared the same experience 9 months earlier. Her legacy, in their eyes, was tainted. Because at the young age of 15, Claudette Colvin became pregnant. And they deemed her entire story and her entire experience as inappropriate. As a young teenage woman, her brave story was forgotten and neglected to this perceived stain on her life's resume. And for years, that stain defined her entire being. For the people around her, that stain seemed to weigh more importance on her than any of her other accomplishments as a registered nurse, as a civil rights activist, and as one of the first plaintiffs in the first federal court case to challenge bus segregation in their city. Claudette's painful story is one that many of us can relate to, where your entire being seems to be defined by a particular stain on your story, a mistake in your story, a perceived sin in your story, and the other characteristics that make you whole as a human. And I think that the reason why many of us have these memories in our lives is because oftentimes the people who refuse to see us as human are the ones that are closest to us. They're your spouses, your significant others, your families, your close friends, your parents, people who you looked up to. And the sad reality is that for many of us, myself included, we are not always the victims in these stories. Sometimes we are the villains that are causing that pain to other people and in their stories. And this particular example, one that Claudette is finding herself in a very unfortunate circumstance, is often based in a justification, in a method that myself I've used, and I can assume that many people that you know have used as well. The sad reality is that for many people like Claudette Colvin, particularly in her scenario, many would say that she embarrassed herself. People in her circle said that she embarrassed her family. And in a time of one of the highest racially divided moments in our country, many people looked at her and said that she embarrassed her community. And others might say that although their love for Claudette is still intact, the response is justified because the word of God is very clear on the boundaries for sexual morality. And therefore, any actions that they take to make sure that she understands that she's made a mistake are completely valid. And I wrestle with that method because in instances in my life, I too have used that same method. Ones that may not look exactly like Claudette Colvin's scenario, but the method behind the circumstance is the same. And so the question that I would want to ask you all and myself is there a better method? Is it possible that there is another response, an alternative approach that Christ has been trying to teach us for so long, and it's been right there in our faces in the Word of God? Is it possible that we've overlooked a reality where truth and unconditional love can coexist with each other at the same time? And that question takes me to the story in Matthew 18, where in verse 21, Peter looks to Jesus and says, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" And Jesus responds in a calm manner and says, "I tell you, not seven times, but 70 times seven." And at first glance, when we read this story, it is easy to assume that this is a very straightforward analogy on the understanding and concept of forgiveness. But I think that there's more to this story than we often let on. Because the more I wrestle with this text, the more I realize that this is not necessarily a story about forgiveness. This is a story about love. One of my favorite books written by an author named George Knight, and I Used to Be Perfect, he breaks down in his commentary on his understanding of this particular encounter that Peter has with Christ. And he says that Peter was not simply asking Jesus about the concept of forgiveness, but rather he was asking about an end date for forgiveness. Peter is asking for limitations on forgiveness. Yet Peter fails to realize that when you place limitations on forgiveness, you're placing limitations on love. And so when Peter looks to Christ and says, "When can I no longer forgive my neighbor?" what he is actually asking Christ is, when is there an end date, a cutoff point, a moment where I can no longer go forward with this love for my neighbor? When can I say is enough is enough? When can I look at my neighbor and say, "You've gone too far," and therefore the love that was promised to you from me is something that you are no longer warranted to? And I think that is a concept that Christ has tried to help not just Peter understand, but for us to understand in the way that we navigate in the world that we live in right now. Because as we wrestle with this idea of what it means to express unconditional love, I can't help but notice what else Christ says in the book of Matthew, chapter 22. Verse 34 through 40, it says that hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in law, tested him with this question. They said, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law, and the prophets hang on these two commandments." And now, when we hear this verse, we've heard it so many times. We recite it. We learn it as kids. There are songs made out of these verses, but if your experience has been anything like mine, I can admit that my understanding of this verse has been very limited. And in some ways, I would go as far as to say my understanding has been distorted in many aspects. Because on the one hand, the Pharisees and Sadducees are not just asking which law is the greatest in terms of significance, in terms of grandeur, and in terms of hierarchy. They are also indirectly asking God, how can we rank these laws? And then once we've ranked these laws, how do we enforce these laws toward our people? How do we make sure that when these laws are not being followed, that there is a proper protocol in how to correct them? How do we make sure that people are always in line with exactly what God wants us to do? And how do we use these methods as a justifying tool to then look toward these people who have broken these laws and to make sure that they understand that they've made a mistake? The Pharisees are looking to Christ and they're saying, we want to know what is the best way to enforce these laws that were given to us. And Christ responds in a way that I think many of us are still wrestling with. He looks to them and he says that if you are truly looking for a way to rank the laws that I have given to you, then what I would say is that loving me and loving your neighbors in an unconditional way are the two greatest commandments. And so what that means is any other law that you see as valuable, as an importance to your spiritual growth, must derive from these two things here. They cannot take a back seat. They cannot be thrown away. They cannot be ignored or neglected. Therefore, if a law is being enforced without love being its driving force, then perhaps these laws are not being enforced properly. And perhaps we're looking at the concept of laws in general improperly. And it's here where I can say that I find myself in this tension of not knowing how to interact with people that I would believe are making choices that are out of bounds towards the laws that Christ has given us. But what Christ is saying here is that the greatest one, the one that he has deemed the most important, the one that he has deemed the most valuable, the most significant, the most impactful, and the most reflective of who he is the law where we are expressing unconditional love to him and to others, to our neighbors, to our friends, to our family members, to our significant others, whether they are following the laws that we believe they should follow or not. Christ is saying that the love has to be the constant variable. And if they are feeling as though love is not relevant in this particular moment, if it is not open in this particular moment, if they cannot see it, if they cannot sense it, if they cannot experience it in this particular moment, then these laws can carry no weight, because love is the foundation for every decision that we make when we interact with God's children. And it's something that I know that I wrestle with at times, because it is tempting to look at these rules as a very clear and black and white guidelines of this is how it's supposed to be. And if you step out of these very clear lines, then you're wrong. And the idea of love entering in to provide this level of nuance makes it so blurry and it makes it complicated to truly know where is the right direction and which path should we follow. But I think it's here where Christ is trying to take us off the hook in saying that space is not one where we will ever fully be able to comprehend. And so if you are looking for a level of comprehension on the value of laws, the first place that we have to always go is love. Because once we truly learn what it means to love our neighbors, then everything else in this holy, sacred book starts to make sense. Thank you.
Simplicity, longing for pure. My heart.
Father God, I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you for being a God of love, a God of unconditional love that is unwavering, Lord. And God, what I'm asking for, not just myself, but for everyone in attendance here, that we can use this as a lesson, as a moment where we can say, God, I want to learn what it means to use love as the foundation for how we navigate through this complex and difficult world that we live in, God. Because it is there where we can truly learn to understand what you were trying to teach us so many years ago in learning what it means to love our neighbors, God, and the power that that verse holds. And that it's not just this wishy-washy verse that just oversimplifies a concept, but in fact, it is the tool and the driving force for everything that we do. And from this point onward, God, we are choosing to use this as a moment to learn and to fully understand what that means. We love you and we thank you. Amen.
You're the reason I sing, the reason I sing. Yes, my heart will sing how I love you, oh my Lord. And Child, like heart, lead me to where
I'll sing.